गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल। टुडेज हॉस्ट एंड पार्क प्रेसिडेंट श्री असलम मर्चेंट जी, पार्क प्रेसिडेंट श्री आनंद गुप्ता जी, प्रेसिडेंट डॉक्टर मनोज पटेल जी, रोटरियन प्रेसिडेंट श्री गौतम चांडे जी, धर्मेंद्र शर्मा जी, सिद्धांत भिड़े, रोटर अपूर्व गंगर, MSW प्रेसिडेंट रमेश प्रभु जी एंड माई को स्पीकर हीरालाल जी सुधर। लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, at the outset, I thank you very much, Rotary Club of Bombay West, for giving me an opportunity to share my knowledge on the proposed Model Tenancy Act 2019, which is gaining attention of people nowadays, mainly with respect to the shift of government from the regulatory regime to free, control-free regime. The core and basic fundamental difference between the earlier model tenancy law and this law is now the entire contract between the landlord and the tenant is based on the agreement between them. Earlier on, the pagri was not it was illegal. Subsequent to that, in 1999, pagri has been made legal. However, still the rent is controlled by the rent control act. So it's a major big shift from that control regime to a free regime. I have made a small presentation on this topic for the day. I'll just share it with you. Mainly, I will be dealing with the structure of dispute resolution under Model Tenancy Act. Basically, this act has been established for appointing a rent authority for regulating renting of premises in efficient and transparent manner and to balance the interest of owner and tenant by establishing adjudicating mechanism for speedy dispute redressal and establish rent court, rent tribunal to hear appeals and for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. See, basically presently the situation is rent control, all the disputes related to owner and tenant is governed and the jurisdiction lies with the small causes court. Now here in this case, the government has proposed 3-tier resolution system. One, the very primary authority is the rent authority. Subsequent to that, the appellate authority is rent court, and the final appellate authority is rent tribunal. It has been very specifically mentioned that there has been no jurisdiction of any other civil court except for the rent court or rent authority with respect to the dispute between landowner and tenant. So wherever there is a dispute between the landowner and tenant with respect to the amount of rent or a possession or a maintenance, all those would be governed strictly under the new proposed law, and no other civil court will have jurisdiction over this. The jurisdiction of rent court will be limited to only the tenancy agreement, and it is submitted to it as per the first schedule in the question of title of ownership and primacy shall be beyond its jurisdiction. In many cases, the disputes between the landlord and tenant are with respect to the title also, and mainly with respect to the tenant, the succession, that the title will go to whom. Like suppose in present case, the tenant, on the death of a tenant, who will inherit his right? That is the biggest problem, and the landlord always never transfer their tenancy to the legal heirs. So all those type of disputes are there. Mainly those have been plugged here by making a very specific mention. And otherwise, any dispute related to the tenant and landowner will be adjudicated by this court. Very important aspect about this particular act is everything is time bound. Now we know that in India, we have a system of tarikh pe tarikh, tarikh pe tarikh, and people get fed up with litigation. So now a big shift in this act is all the proceedings are made time bound, and there is been a time specified in the law that within particular number of days the decision should come. And in case there has been a delay, the concerned authority is duty bound to record the reason for the delay in writing. As I said, there is a 3-tier resolution mechanism. First is a rent authority. I am just sharing this, that who would be the authority, just for a general understanding. Here the rent authority is a very preliminary authority which has a summary power, and that will be also an officer of a deputy, rank of a deputy collector, which is an administrative body. There is no judicial body involved at the rent authority level. All the orders passed by rent authority are appealable, and they can be appealed before the rent court. Rent court consists of two members. One will be appointed by state and in consultation with high court. So, and one is from the state judiciary. So both would be a member for judicial background. Rent tribunal will have three members: principal appellate member and two other judicial members from the state services. So it has been an experience of in India that the tribunalization has been effective. Like in this case, generally a civil court earlier had a jurisdiction. Here it has been made that the tribunal will have a final jurisdiction. So there are lot many tribunals like industrial dispute tribunal, income tax appellate tribunal, excise tribunal. So it is an now of late is a NCLT. In the RERA there is a tribunal. So it is an understanding of the government that if there is a specific tribunal set up which deals with the disputes related to a particular nature only, the resolution is also fast, and it effectively resolves the issues between the people. But the only drawback in those tribunals is about the appointment of less number of judicial people, or having a combination of a judicial and a technical member and all. So it seems that in this case, considering the earlier remarks of Supreme Court in some of the judgment, the government is planning to have judicial members in rent court and rent tribunal to effectively deal with the problems. The nature of proceedings between the three authorities would be like this. Rent authority, the proceedings will be summary proceedings. Summary proceedings are still different than the normal court proceedings, because in summary proceedings it does not involve lot of the procedural part. Based on the document, the authority decides what is the situation. Like in check bouncing cases, 138 is there, which is a summary proceeding. There it doesn't go beyond a particular level of documentation. Once the check is issued, if it is bounced, there is an offense. There is no other explanation to be given. Similarly, in summary proceedings also, in case of this tenancy also, as Suthardi mentioned, the agreement is the most important document in this entire proceeding. If in the agreement it is mentioned that the tenant will vacate the premises after 12 months, then he has to vacate the premises. There is no other option with respect to any defense by the tenant. So it would be a summary proceeding. However, a safeguard is also provided that if suppose there is some injustice has been done in summary proceeding, then there is an appellate mechanism available before the rent court. Rent court has got both the jurisdiction and original jurisdiction also. Some issues could be before the rent court and as an original jurisdiction, and some would be the appellate proceedings. So appellate proceedings would be the order which was passed by the rent authority would be challenged before the appellate proceedings. After appellate proceedings, all the order passed by appellate proceedings, that is the rent court, if the person is still aggrieved, there is a second level of appellate proceedings, that is rent tribunal. Rent tribunal will be having the appellate jurisdiction only, and all the orders passed by rent court would be appealable before rent tribunal. And the rent tribunal is the final authority. There is nothing beyond rent tribunal as an appellate proceeding. In case the person is aggrieved with respect to some violation of fundamental right or something, then there is a writ jurisdiction, which is a general jurisdiction available before the High Court. So in this three-tier jurisdiction, three-tier mechanism, the problem would be solved. And in all the three-tier mechanism, there has been a number of days specified that within how many days the issue should be resolved. Another aspect of this dispute resolution is in India, for civil courts are governed by the Code of Civil Procedure, where there has been a laid down procedure is there. where people have to follow that procedure for the disposal of or at the time of their fee. In this tribunal and rent court, they are not bound by the procedure laid down by Code of Civil Procedure. However, they have been given specific power with respect to enforcing attendance, verification of document, inspection of site, appointment of commission, etc. The procedure for filing the application is as under. Every application which is filed before the authority would be with the affidavit. The basic concept is whenever person is affirming on affidavit, he is affirming on oath. So any wrong statement given in the affidavit is a criminal offense. So a safeguard has been kept here that to avoid frivolous applications or an application with a wrong fact or with a malafide intention, to avoid that, every application must be with an affidavit. As soon as that application is filed, rent court or rent tribunal issues notice to the other party. Here also it is provided that the other party should file his reply with affidavit and document. So he also cannot take it for a right that anything can be replied to the application filed. So he has also to give his reply under affidavit along with the document on which he is relying. One more opportunity is given to the applicant to file his rejoinder. So suppose you have filed an application, the other party has contended that what I am saying in my application is not correct, and as an applicant is I want to further say something on that, so then I have been given a chance of rejoinder. Once rejoinder is filed, a personal hearing is conducted, and during the hearing also the proceedings will be a summary inquiry based on the document which is submitted. And during that hearing proceedings, if the authority or the court or the tribunal is of the opinion that attendance of some witness is required or a cross-examination of witness is required, the court can allow that witness and cross-examination also. It is provided in the Act that they would make a standard form for filing an application and also for filing an appeal, so that there would be a standardization, because generally nowadays there is a trend in judiciary that we advocates ourselves, we file very lengthy pleadings and applications and all, which runs into quite number of pages. To avoid that, they have decided to have some standardized application form wherein the issues would be mentioned and what is the resolution is the person applicant is seeking for. So this would be good. This has been done in the RERA tribunal also and in NCLT also. They have a standard format. You have to fill up the query or your dispute in that format, and your prayer also should be mentioned in brief to avoid a huge data. As I said, the entire procedure is time based, and generally it has been seen that the matter gets delayed because either party keeps asking for adjournment. So here very specifically provided in the Act that court or tribunal shall not ordinarily grant more than 3 adjournment. Maximum adjournment can be granted is 3, because the time limit has been given. So otherwise it will keep on applying for adjournment, and your matter goes on for years together. So to avoid that, it has been specifically provided. However, if any additional adjournment is given for a circumstance is beyond control, something like suppose like now this COVID is there, from last almost 7-8 months the courts are not functioning. During such period, if there is something which is beyond control and some adjournments are required to be given, in that case the adjournment can be given with a reasonable cause. Of course, not for the COVID thing, but similar such adjournments are seek by the either of the party, there would be some cost involved. It is been provided that the case should be disposed of within a period of 60 days from the date of application. So there is a specific time limit given in the Act that it should be disposed of within a 60 days period, and the procedure at that earlier reply and rejoinder whatever has been mentioned here has to be complied within this particular period. In case the decision cannot be taken in 60 days, in that event, a reason should be recorded in writing. Now, See, this is a provision made in the Act, right? So, as a citizen, we have a right. Generally, it is seen that though the intent is there in the Act that the resolution should be time bound, but it takes quite number of years, right? Like the live example is RERA. In RERA also, the Act has provided, legislature has provided that there should be a time bound resolution. However, it has been seen that the resolution, the getting hearing for the complaint only takes 4 to 6 months. So, but in all such events, there has to be a reason recorded in writing. So, a aggrieved party has a right, they can apply to the court or an authority and ask, kindly give us the copy of the reasons which have been recorded and why this resolution, why this complaint has not been disposed of within the specified date. There has been a time limit mentioned for the repossession of premises also, and it is from the 90 days from the date of filing of application. There are many reasons why the repossession can be required by the landowner, and there the time limit is given in 90 days, wherein in the present case it remains, it goes for years together, maybe generations actually. So that time limit is there. There is one another in there, there is an exception that if the repossession is for the misuse, as Tusharji mentioned, the water is called as misuse. For misuse, there is a provision that the landowner should give an intimation to the tenant that you are misusing the premises, then the purpose for which I have given, and you should stop it immediately. However, he doesn't stop the misuse of the premises, then the landowner can make an application and that repossession should be given within the period of 30 days. So there the period of 90 days is also not applicable. Within the period of 30 days, that application should be resolved. There are some inherent powers given to the court also for the purpose of inquiry, power to enter and inspect premises. There is a very specific power given to the court. Sometimes what happens, suppose there is a complaint with respect to unauthorized construction in the premises which is given on rent. And if court is of the opinion that it requires some physical inspection to go at the site and check, then court has been given a power. It can appoint an officer who can go to the particular premises and make a report and give it to the court. Court can also call for the inspections of books and documents if during the course of proceeding it is required. There is another power to appoint assessor, valuer, advisor. This would be, in my opinion, could be a case where there has been some expenditure incurred by the tenant and it has been provided that it can adjust it out of the rent payable to the landowner. And if that amount is disproportionate, then in that event, the court may appoint some assessor or valuer to go and value that the cost involved incurred by the tenant. Rent court has been given a power of judicial magistrate of first class for the recovery of fine under the provision of Code of Criminal Procedure, and the rent court shall be deemed to be a magistrate under the said court for the purpose of recovery. This is very important power given to the court, and there is no separate institution of suit required. I think this could be mainly with respect to, suppose you have given the check, the tenant has given a check for the rent and that check is bounced. So normally you have a mechanism available under Criminal Procedure 138. I think this section is perimaterial to that. So you can, the court itself has the power to do that, to take an action on that. The court has been given a power to execute its order as the decree of civil court. And while executing the order, rent court can deliver what, suppose the order has been passed that the possession should be handed over to the landowner. And for execution of such order, court has a power to give the possession. In case there is an order with respect to payment of rent, outstanding rent, then court has a power to attach bank account. And for executing its order, court can take the help of the police or a local body like municipality and all. And of course, only in this case, in the case of taking help from the police, the cost of police is to be borne by the applicant. But you don't have to go again to a third party for execution. Like in RERA, there are huge number of orders passed against the builders. But it has been a trend that almost more than 90% of the orders are not executed only. Because the RERA doesn't have an execution power. Execution actually is done by the collector office. a person then again after that order run to the collector office and get that order executed. So here in this case, to avoid such thing, the power has been given directly to the rent court only for granting possession and attaching bank account also. There is also a provision made, time bound provision for execution proceedings to be completed in summary manner within 30 days. So at the time of execution, there is no other proceedings to be carried out, and the entire proceeding should be completed within the period of 30 days. Appeal before tribunal. These are the, as I said, that the rent, the decision given by the rent court or the order given by the rent court is appealable before the tribunal. And here also the time bound procedure is that the order passed by the rent court can be appealed against the rent tribunal within a period of 30 days from the date of final order. Tribunal should serve notice on the respondent and fix hearing within 30 days of the service of notice of the appeal on the respondent. Tribunal should dispose of the appeal within a period of 120 days. So here also there is a time limit with respect to service of the notice and also with respect to completing the appellate proceeding. And within 120 days from the date of service of notice, the proceeding should be completed. Here in this case, tribunal has been given a special power to allow an exception document. Suppose during the lower court proceedings, you have not been able to provide certain document which you feel is important to establish your case, then in that case, tribunal has been given a power to allow document. But this power is only can be used once. Then a person can have an opportunity to submit document only once. Tribunal also has been given power to pass interlocutory order. So till the time that final hearing is there and tribunal feels that in the immediate interest of the appellant some order is required to be passed, then it has a power to pass interlocutory order. Court fees, there is a fees payable on filing suit in the rent court, application in the rent court, rent tribunal and the authorities. And for the purpose of that, Court Fees Act 1870 would be applicable. Like in RERA, suppose there is a standard fee of 5,000 rupees for filing a complaint. There is no such provision here. Here the court fees would be as per the Court Fees Act, which is applicable. As mentioned by Sudhaji, all earlier proceedings would continue under the old act. So there is, it is not that the rest, this act has a retrospective effect. It will be applicable prospectively. However, the act has given an option to the plaintiff. Suppose somebody has filed a case in the notary's court in the current Maharashtra Rent Control Act, and if he decides that he wants to get this particular dispute adjudicated under the new act, he has been given a time limit of 180 days. From the commencement of that, he can take a decision whether he wants to continue under the old regime or wants to get the benefit of the new regime. And once he decides that he wants to come under the new regime, he has to withdraw the suit filed in the under the old suit, and within 270 days, he should file the suit within the under the new law. And if it is filed within that time, it will be a compliance of the requirement. I think with the time allotted to me, I have tried to give a broad outlook with how the entire proceedings would work. And if any questions are there, we can take up at that point of time.